परिवराजकाचार्य अष्टोत्तर शतशिशमसचिवाइन्द्रे अवे चरणारविंद भक्ति विदांत स्वामी श्रील प्रभुपाद की अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की नामाचार्य हरिदास ठाकुर की प्रेम से कहो श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद की श्री श्री राधा कृष्ण गोप गोपीनाथ श्याम कुंड राधा कुंड गिरी गोवर्धन की परिभूम दामन धाम की मथुरा धाम की द्वारकापुरी धाम की पुरुषोत्तम क्षेत्र जगन्नाथपुरी धाम की श्री मायापुरम धाम की गंगमय यमुनामय की भक्त तुलसी देवी की समावेद भक्त वृंद की ऑल ग्लोरीज टू असेंबल्ड डिवोटीज ऑल ग्लोरीज टू असेंबल्ड डिवोटीज ऑल ग्लोरीज टू असेंबल्ड डिवोटीज ऑल ग्लोरीज ऑल ग्लोरीज ऑल ग्लोरीज टू श्री गुरु एंड श्री गौरांग ॐ अज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुः उन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपः कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरोः श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरून् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगण रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवम् साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधा कृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे वांछाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। युवालादशी तृतीय दुसरे श्लोकास नाव। ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ईशावास्यमिदं सर्वं यत्किञ्च जगत्यां जगत् तेन त्यक्तेन भुञ्जीथामागृधक्कस्य सिद्धनम् कुर्वन्नेवेह कर्माणि जिजीविशेषतं समाः एवं त्वयि नान्यथेतोऽस्ति न कर्म लिप्यते नरे। सूर्यानाम ते लोका अंधेन तमसा वृताः कांस्ते प्रेत्याभिगच्छन्ति ये के चात्महनो जनाः। अनेजदेकं मनसो जवीयो नैनद्देवा आप्नुवन् पूर्वमर्षत् तद्धावतोऽन्यानत्येति तिष्ठत्तस्मिन्नपोमातरिष्वा दधाति। तदेजति तन्नैजति तद्दूरे तद्वन्तिके तदन्तरस्य सर्वस्य तदु सर्वस्यास्य वाह्यतः। यस्तु सर्वाणि भूतानि आत्मन्येवानुपश्यति सर्वभूतेषु चात्मानं ततो न विजुगुप्सते। यस्मिन् सर्वाणि भूतानि आत्मैवाभूद्विजानतः तत्र को मोहकशोक एकत्वमनुपश्यतः। सपर्यगा शुक्रमकायमव्रणम् अस्नाविरं शुद्धमपापविद्धम् कविर्मनीषी परिभूः स्वयं भूर्याथा दत्यतोर्तान् प्रददाच्चाश्वतीभ्यः समाभ्यः। अन्धम् तमः प्रविशन्ति ये अविद्यामुपासते ततो भूय इव ते तमो यौ विद्यायां रताः। अन्यदेवाहुर्विद्यया अन्यदाहुरविद्यया इति सुश्रुमधीराणां येनस्तद्विचक्षिरे। विद्यां च विद्यां च यस्तद्वेदोभयं सह अविद्यया मृत्युं तीर्त्वा विद्यया मृतमश्नुते। अन्धं तमः प्रविशन्ति ये असम्भूतिमुपासते ततो भूय इव ते तमो ययु सम्भूत्यां व्रताः। अन्यदेवाहु संभवादन्यदाहुरसम्भवात् विश्वमधीराणां येनस्तच्चक्षिरे। सम्भूतिं च विनाशं च यस्तद्वेदोभयं सह विनाशेन मृत्युं तीर्त्वा सम्भूत्यामृतमश्नुते। हिरण्मयेन पात्रेण सत्यस्यापि हितं मुखं तत्त्वं पूषण्णपावृणु सत्यधर्माय दृष्टये। पूषण्णेकर्षे यमसूर्यप्राजापत्य व्योहरश्मेन् समूहतेजः। यत्ते रूपं कल्याणतमं तत्ते पश्यामि योऽसावसौ पुरुषः सोऽहमस्मि। वायुनलिलम् अमृतम् अथेदं भस्मान्तं शरीरम्। ॐ क्रतोस्मर कृतं स्मर क्रतोस्मर कृतं स्मर। अग्ने नय सुपतराये अस्मान् विश्वानि देववयुनानि विद्वान्। युयोद्यस्मज्जुहुराणमेनो भूयिष्ठां ते नम भुक्तिं विधेम। हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। We'll see the PowerPoint of the 7th verse and then we go to the 8th verse today. In the 6th verse I wanted to show something. Somebody can read the shloka of the 6th verse. This is verse number 6. मंत्र 6 विजन ऑफ महाभागवत
यस्तु सर्वाणि भूतानि आत्मन्येवानुपश्यति सर्वभूतेषु चात्मानं ततो न विजुगुप्सते
ट्रांसलेशन
He who sees systematically everything in relation to the Supreme Lord, who sees all living entities as his parts and parcels, and who sees the Supreme Lord within everything, never hates anything or any being.
So, 6, 7, 8 are in one family of verses. Just like I told you, 1, 2, 3. Correct, no? Similarly, 6, 7, 8 are like one group. Therefore, now you can see the connection. So, what is the vision of Mahabhagavat? He sees the Lord in the heart of every living being. Correct? And then what is the second type of thing he sees? The same translation.
Parts, living entities as his parts and parcels and who sees the Supreme Lord within everything.
He sees the Jiva as a part and parcel of Krishna. And in the heart of every Jiva, he sees Krishna. See here, now you can see the flow chart. Vision of a spiritual advanced devotees. See, Kanishta Madhyam, Madhyam Uttama, there are three types of devotees. We have to develop a spiritual vision. In order for us to do that, we should know what to accept and what to avoid. That means how to see and how not to see. So let us see how the Kanishta sees. Please read the different items in Kanishta.
Lowest stage, goes to temple, nowhere else, cannot ascertain others' position, follows routine, quarrels, materialistic devotees.
He may be able to do routine devotion, but he cannot break a lesser rule for a greater rule. He doesn't know neophyte. He cannot understand the value of devotees. And he thinks outsider having difficulty and devotee having difficulty is same, he thinks. He doesn't know that a devotee's struggle is for becoming Krishna conscious, while the outsider's struggle is for enjoying Maya more. So Kanishta is in that way not sympathetic. And Kanishta also thinks high of himself. Atmano Bhakti Darpataha. He thinks he is a better devotee than everybody else. Kanishta outlook. Like for example, when Vidura returned back to deliver his brother Dhritarashtra, at that time, he did not tell the Pandavas about the destruction of Yadu dynasty. And that is one Nan Bishakam, it is said. Nanva Priyam. It says that Apriyam means Pandavas, if they hear about Krishna and Yadu's, you know, leaving this world, they will break down to tears. All day they would have cried. So therefore, what he did, Vidura? He kept quiet because such things will eventually come to be known. Like for example, if one devotee was in the ashram, now he moved to the next ashram. So some people go and tell everybody, do you know? He left. It's not required. It will come to be known eventually. You don't have to talk about that. Correct? Actually, we can try to know the glories of the devotees, which we can share with others very liberally. And when we know some problems of the devotees, which we keep with ourselves, we may not share it with others. And there's no need, because it will come to be known to others. Like that's what he thought, Vidura. That means, is he Kanishta or Madhyam? Correctness, beyond Madhyam. Correct, no? Because that maturity is there. He doesn't speak unnecessarily things. Whereas you find some people tend to speak things unnecessarily. That means Kanishta. Kanishta means one cannot hold confidence. Now you will see Madhyama, second stage. So these four things you all know. What does he do with the Supreme Lord? He loves. And devotees, he makes friendships. With innocent people, he preaches. And atheists, he avoids. And Uttamadhikari, read it.
Sees everything in relation to Supreme Lord, does not discriminate between atheist and theist, Brahman and dog, sees in terms of using or...
Why he doesn't discriminate? He sees soul in all the bodies. Pandita? Yeah.
Sees in terms of using or misusing independence.
That means Pandita Samadarshana is not for Vaishnavas. It is only for Jnanis. Jnanis see all souls equally. Vaishnavas, in the soul also they see difference. Vaishnavas. That is explained in 3rd canto, 29th chapter. I think 22 to 29, I think 3rd canto, 29th chapter, if you read, you will find out. Lord Kapila says that Vaishnavas see gradations in Jivas. Beginning with dry grass has no life, green grass has life, then the plants and trees are better, then the birds are better, animals are even better, and human beings are better. Amongst humans, Brahmanas are better. Amongst Brahmanas, one who knows Vedanta is better. Amongst those who know Vedanta, one who can cut the false arguments with logic are even more better. And those who not only present the philosophy logically and defeats others, but one who applies it in his life is even more better. And amongst those Brahmanas who apply in their life perfectly, the Vaishnava is better. And amongst the Vaishnavas, Ekanta Bhakta or Kevala Bhakta, Shuddha Bhakta, he is best. Like that Kapila says. So Kapila says there is a gradation of living entities even in the souls also. So Jnanis see all the souls as equal because they see Supreme Brahman everywhere. They think all souls are ultimately Supreme Brahman. But Vaishnava doesn't see like that. Vaishnava sees every jiva in relation to Supreme Lord. Like that he says. That means a jiva is this much far away from Krishna, this much far away, this much far away. Pure devotees are like this. They are the closest to Krishna. And all others are, so Vaishnava, when he sees all jivas, oh, he's a dog. That means he's gone too far away from Krishna. And somebody is a Brahmana, oh, he has come a little more near. Somebody is a Vaishnava, you know, that means he sees in relation to their connection with Krishna. And if he sees somebody very far away, he doesn't ridicule them, he feels compassion for them. He tries to deliver them. That is the Vaishnava devotee. Yeah, and then?
Sees in terms of using or misusing independence, not misled by material bodies, sees spiritual spark.
Yeah. Now we are coming in the sixth mantra. It was also taught to us how to develop a spiritual vision, what to avoid and what to accept. Yeah. We should not imitate a Uttamadhikari. And we should not avoid speaking in the parampara, which means we should not bluff on our own. You study, remember and repeat in parampara, and don't imitate a Uttamadhikari, he says. And then and that he says, you know, don't behave on bodily platform, which is Yashatma Buddhir Kunapetri Dhatuki, that verse. And false philanthropy means some just social service without Krishna consciousness. And then politicians offering some drinking, smoking, cinema theatres and liquor shops and all that. And without any information of spiritual world. And motive for fame and reward, you know, without serving the purpose of soul. All these things should be avoided to avoid bodily consciousness. And what to accept? Anupashyati. Instead of being an imitator of Uttamadhikari, become a follower of Uttamadhikari. Is there? And instead of avoiding disabling succession and bluffing from one's own brain substance, instead one should be consistent with Srila Vedavyasa's works. In order to do that, how do we do that? Follow disabling succession. Our commentary should be in line in parampara, Gita Bhagavatam, and develop a firm faith in Krishna and his divine energy, Radharani. Okay. So here, if you see this beautiful chart here, see that if the object is material, your vision is also material. That leads to metal bondage. That's what is happening to all the materialistic people. And the example is, one shloka in Bhagavatam says that Pumsaha Striya Mituni Bhavametat Tayor Mito Hridaya Granti Mahuhu Ato Griha Kshetra Sutapta Vidair Janasya Moho Yamaham Mameti. Here is one definition of Moha. Moha means man and woman mutually become attracted to each other, and then the bondage accrues and appears in the form of children and the home and the facilities at home and land and economic development. In this way, their family and materialistic life expands with no essence of God consciousness. That is one type of moha, he says. Another type of moha is, so in this moha, first attraction is to opposite sex, then the attraction to the children, attraction to land, attraction to money, attraction to facilities, material facilities, and attraction to name, fame, glory. And becoming completely swallowed by these things is called moha, because This makes us forget the Supreme Lord completely. Correct, no? And in the same manner, it is Dehapatya Kalatradishu, Atmaseneshu, Asatsu Api, Tesham, Pramatto Nidhanam. That Pramatta is actually Moha. Pashyan Api, Pashyati. He can see that his grandfather has passed away, grandmother has passed away, father, mother have passed away, he will also pass away. But still, he is materialistic. He is simply spending his time and accumulating money and watching movie, eating nice food. And like Prabhupada says, there are even nationalist Prabhupada contempt. He says, people are fighting for their country. But you know, when two countries are fighting, they die. And then they are the bodies are sent to the graveyard to be simply burnt to ashes. And next life you are born, you can't say, my country, you will be born in another country. He says. So, in this way, that is also another type of moha. So, moha begins with our own body. Maha moha means extensions like wife, children, land and grandmother, grandfather, mother, father, which also includes the nation or place of birth, all those things. Yeah. So, that's material vision. Second one is material object. And then, what is the vision?
Spiritual vision.
If you look at a material object, spiritual vision, then what happens? Consequence.
Purification. Utility is the principle.
Yes. Prabhupada was walking on the road, he saw a bus and asked devotees, look at that nice bus, then can use it for Sankirtan. He looked at another building and said, hey, look at this grand building, it looks very elegant. Can they donate it to ISKCON? So that means he is looking at material objects, but with a spiritual vision. He is trying to use it in Krishna's service. How they can be utilized. Yeah. The third one?
Spiritual object, material vision.
That's where the offense comes. I told you, Archie, Vishnu, Shiradir, Gurushi Naramatir, Vaishnava Jati Buddhi, all those list of items. Yeah, and example?
Idolatry vision of Jewish rabbi.
Yeah, sometimes some rabbi may come and see that we are worshipping a deity in the temple. He may think of it to be ordinary idol. So, that's a material vision of the deity. But in the Sakshi Gopal pastime, that Brahmana had firm faith in the deity. Correct? No? So, he had what vision he had? Spiritual vision. So, he saw a spiritual Lord with a spiritual vision. So, Lord agreed to walk behind him and also speak to him. Just like in Madhavendra Puri's pastime, also Raghunandan Thakur's pastime. So, they all saw the deity with a spiritual vision. That's the last one. That means spiritual object, you see.
For a neophyte,
it leads to purification. For an advanced devotee, it leads to ecstasy. Correct, no? Yeah. Neophyte devotee, when he sees things with spiritual vision, he gets purified. Like all of us, we are neophytes. We come to the temple hall, look at the Lord, bow down, circumambulate him with great faith. Then we get purified. And then very advanced devotees, you know, like Madhavendra Puri, for example, and so they feel ecstasy when they see spiritual objects. When they hear the holy name, like Mahaprabhu's dancing, here's the holy name. Holy name is spiritual, deities are spiritual, holy places are spiritual. When he sees devotees, he feels very enlivened also. So that is, example is deity or Vaishnava. So you got this idea, no? That means we have a material vision and a spiritual vision. And we have a material vision towards material objects that leads to bondage, and material vision towards spiritual objects leads to offense. And a spiritual vision towards material objects means that is called as Maya Tatapitam Sarvam. Prabhupada says everything can be engaged in. Spiritual vision towards material object means utility is the principle. And spiritual vision towards spiritual objects means ecstasy or purification. Nice, no? So you get amongst this, which one you will select? Second and fourth. Spiritual vision. Vision should be what? We should see with prema chakshu. Everything. And we should avoid material vision. Because material vision is anyway bad. If you see material objects, you get bound, attached. And if you see spiritual objects with material vision, offense. So either way, that means one causes sins, another one causes offenses. Correct, no? So you want which one? Sin or offense? Neither. One give up both. On the other hand, if you have spiritual vision, one causes purification, one causes ecstasy in advanced stages. So we want to have spiritual vision. Okay, Mantra 7. Somebody read the stroka, Mantra 7. We finished this in the previous class.
यस्मिन् सर्वाणि भूतानि आत्मैवाभूद् विजानतः तत्र को मोह कः शोक एकत्वम् अनुपश्यतः.
यस एंड ट्रांसलेशन.
वन हु ऑलवेज सीज ऑल लिविंग एंटिटीज एज स्पिरिचुअल स्पार्क्स इन क्वालिटी वन विद द लॉर्ड बिकम्स ए ट्रू नोअर ऑफ थिंग्स. What then can be illusion or anxiety for him?
This was emphasizes about the oneness aspect between the Lord and the living entities in consciousness, in spirit, in a cooperative mentality. Like one example I'll tell you. When people hear about Krishna doing rasa dance with the gopis, many people, due to their own lusty heart, they think this is also some kind of, you know, romantic activity, like what boys and girls do in this world. It's a very mean-minded vision. There are various reasons explained in the Shastra why rasa dance should not be thought of to be ordinary, because it is so glorious that even Shiva, Parvati and Brahma and Saraswati and Indra and Sachi, they are all flying in the airplanes and showering flowers. During this dance, the greatest dance of the whole universe, Lord dancing with the purest of the devotees. And it is, and all the gopis are in the ecstatic trance in that dance. So, this thought came to my mind. In the Bhagavatam, it is said that a child sometimes may be lying on the floor, in the mirror-like floor, looking his own reflection. And he may be beating the floor like this and laughing. Similarly, Krishna was dancing with the gopis, like that Bhagavatam says. That means he was dancing with whom? His own part and parcels. He was dancing. Actually, that is the relationship Krishna has with all his part and parcels, whether they be cows or calves, whether they be covered boys, whether they be parents or lovers. So I had gone to this Vrindavan temple once. Aindrapur was singing in those days, many years ago. I was sitting by the side and clapping hands and taking part in the kirtan. So one family came, one husband, wife and four children, two sons and two daughters. So they all are grown up. They must be probably in 6th or 7th or 8th standard, like that I think. Two daughters, two sons and father and mother. So they came to the temple hall, took darshan, and Aindrapur started kirtan. It was so attractive. So they all caught their hands like this and made a circle. Father, mother, two daughters and two sons. How many totally? Six of them made a circle and they started dancing towards center and going, catching the hands, making a circle. So, brahmacharis felt that they wanted to say that Mataji should go to that side and Prabhuji should come to this side. Of course, they didn't say. They told the watchman. So, the watchman went and told them, "Hey, I said dancing nahin karne ka." He said, "Mataji, you go that side, Prabhuji come this side." Of course, they separated after that. But when I saw them, at that time I felt there is a oneness amongst them, correct? No? Because they are all one family, correct? No? Do you think there is any vikar in their minds? They are all completely innocent. They are simply dancing for the pleasure of the Lord and they are releasing the kirtan. Just as they all are one in spirit of the same family, hearing the kirtan, they are innocent, correct? No? That is the mood in which Krishna dances with gopis. Because for Krishna and the gopis, who are his parts and parcel, they are all one family only. He doesn't have any vikar like we have vikar in our heart. Our vikar is due to our bhogavritti. And Krishna has no bhogavritti. Where there is no bhogavritti, there is no vikar also. Just like the old version lady climbed on the shoulder of Mahaprabhu and then the Garuda Stambha. You know, although it is happens to Lord and the devotee, but what was her vision? Vision was spiritual or material? Spiritual. So she saw Lord Jagannath, the spiritual vision. So there was no offense at all on her part. And Mahaprabhu not only forgave her offense, Mahaprabhu also glorified her spiritual vision. Correct, no? So because there is no vikar there. As soon as the vikar has come, the transformation, material transformation comes. That's where the problem starts. You understand, no? So therefore the 7th verse talks about the oneness aspect. Spiritual oneness. Only Uttamadhikari can see. So this we already have seen it. We'll go to the next verse now. When you see such oneness, you surrender to Krishna. You are free from mental miseries. Freedom from illusion and lamentation. See, when jnanis become free from illusion, they become very proud. But when devotees become free from illusion, they don't become proud for one reason. Because mamyeviye prapadyante mayamaitam. So they know very well that because I am taking shelter of Krishna, Krishna kindly is keeping me free from illusion. It is not my ability. It is Krishna's strength that keeps me free from illusion. Because even the very intelligent sages have fallen down. Like you will see this verse, yatato hyapi kaunteya purushasya vipaschitaha indriyani pramatini haranti prasavam manaha. Krishna is telling. He's saying, yatato hyapi kaunteya, Arjuna, even though they are vipaschit jnanis. Vipaschit means those who have viveka buddhi and very good clarity they have. They are deeply learned in Shastra. They can see what is what. What is asat, what is sat. They have studied Sankhya and all very deeply. Even such jnanis, he says, indriyani pramatini, the senses are strong and impetuous. Haranti prasavam mana means they can snatch away the mind and senses even of a great jnani, exactly like a lion or a tiger, you tied with a rope. Suddenly they cut the rope and slaps on your face and runs into the forest. Like that, he says. This example is given by Rishabhadev. In the fifth canto, fifth chapter, you will read that. So, one should not be very proud of one's sense control or mind control, because anytime, so jnanis become foolishly proud. They think that by my austerities, I have controlled them. Whereas bhaktas know that by Krishna's blessing and Guru's blessing, I am able to maintain my regulative principles. So, that is one very important thing. Yeah. So, effect of rejecting oneness is what? It leads to godless civilization and people identifying with the material bodies and nationalism and politics and everything. It's full of anxieties. The result of a godless civilization is? Illusion is born of godless civilization and the result of such illusion is lamentation. Yeah. See a person, if a person is a materialist, he is attached to matter and detached from Krishna. Detached from Krishna, he doesn't have interest in Krishna. But he is attached to matter. And Mayavadi?
He is detached to matter and detached to Krishna.
He has neither interest in material world nor interested in serving Krishna in spiritual world. He is hanging, in the Brahma Jyoti. And her Sahaja?
Attached to matter and attached to Krishna.
Yeah. They have attachment to Krishna, which is very nice, but they are also attached to matter. Due to this, they tend to indulge in illicit activities and they fall down. And devotee?
Detached from matter and attached to Krishna.
Yes, virakti for matter. What is the vairagya vidya? Nijabhakti yogam, shikshakameta purusha purana. He says, Sri Krishna Chaitanya Shariradhari, Shariradhari, Kripam Buddhi, Tam. Sharanam prapadya. So that he says vairagya vidya. So devotee should have vairagya. One more verse I'll tell you. What it was? Na viragaya kalpate, na tirthapate sevaya, jivana pimbuto hi saha. Na viragaya kalpate. Bhagavatam is coming. Bhagavatam was coming. నేహయత్ కర్మ ధర్మాయ నా విరాగాయ కల్పతే నా తీర్థపద సేవాయై జీవన్నపి మృతో హి సః.
Anyone whose work is not meant to elevate him to religious life, anyone whose religious ritualistic performances do not raise him to renunciation, and anyone situated in renunciation that does not lead him to devotional service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead must be considered dead, although he is breathing.
Right, na? Huh? Anyone who is doing work means what? Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. Whatever work you do, offer it to Lord Vishnu. And then, it should lead to religious principle. That means gradually you become a pious person, religious person, going to temple and everything. And gradually you come to renunciation. And then that should lead you to devotion service. Otherwise, one is considered dead, he's saying. Simply working for hard, Nunam Pramata Kurte Vikarma Yadindri Priti Apranoti, or like that. Other verse, or that, Nayam Deho. That only. If one is only working hard and is not arriving at the religious principles and renunciation. Now, all of us, as devotees, you know, we were working in the outside world before. Then we picked up religious principles, dharmic principles. Now, say we have come to the point of dedicating our lives. Now, is it leading to renunciation or bhogavritti? After coming here, are you doing bhoga or in the renunciation? What are you doing? We should check. Gradually, virakti should arise in our heart. If virakti is not arising, the loop is not complete. Correct, no? Imagine somebody says, Prabhupada says, I am a big, big devotee and I have big, big enjoying propensity. Prabhupada says, what is the big, big devotee? You are a cheater, he says. Prabhupada says. So the big devotee means he should have given up enjoying propensity. And then that should lead to sincere practice of devotional service.
Okay. That is the mantra 8 now, no, today. Mantra 7 we had just not seen. Did this be completed? Okay. Let's go to mantra 8 now. Mantra 8 also is connected. Read that.
Mantra 8 mentions some of the qualities of the Lord as he is known by his Uttam Adhikari, by the Uttam Adhikari mentioned in Mantra 7.
Yeah, so Mantra 6 said about what? The vision of a Mahabhagavata devotee, Uttam Adhikari devotee. Yeah? And Mantra 7 spoke about? Yeah? Oneness. Yeah, spiritual oneness. And now Mantra 8 is talking about qualities of the Lord as it is known to the Uttam Adhikari. Yeah. So, all three are talking about Uttam Adhikari's vision. But since we need to know Uttam Adhikari means what? So, the distinction is given between Uttam Adhikari and Madhyama and Kanishtha also. So, we can know where we are and we can also have aspiration where to go. Correct, no? Yeah. Please read the main thing.
Lord has a transcendental form and attributes that are unlike that of any materially embodied entity.
Yeah. Lord has a spiritual form, unlike the material living entities. So we'll recite the verse, 8th verse. Sapar yaga chukramaka yama vranam asnaviram shuddham apapavidham kavir manishi paribhusvayambhur याता तत्यदोर्थान तददा चाश्वतिभ्यः समाभ्यः या व्हाट टू व्हाट
सह दैट पर्सन पर्यगात मस्ट नो इन फैक्ट शुक्रम द ओमनीपोटेंट अकायम अनएम्बॉडीड अवरणम विदाउट रिप्रोच अश्नावीरम विदाउट वेन्स शुद्धम एंटीसेप्टिक अपापविद्धम प्रोफिलेक्टिक कवि ओमनिशियंट मनीषी फिलोसोफर परिभू द ग्रेटेस्ट ऑफ ऑल स्वयंभू सेल्फ सफिशियंट याथा तथ्यतः जस्ट इन पर्सुएंस ऑफ अर्थान डिजायरेबल्स व्यदधात अवार्ड्स शाश्वतिभ्यः इमेमोरियल Samabhyaha, time.
Yeah, so if you see, Sa Pariyagat, that means one should know the Lord's qualities. He says, what are his qualities? He begins from that list. First quality is Shukram. He is omnipotent or powerful. And Akayam, he is unembodied, which means he is not trapped in the material body like us. His body and soul are same, non-different. And Avranam, without reproach. And Asnaviram, without any bones or veins in his body. So how many are over? Shukram, Akayam, Avranam, Asnaviram, 4. And Shuddham, antiseptic, 5. And 6 is Apapavitam, prophylactic. And 7 is Kavihi, is omniscient. And 8 is Manishi, is philosopher. The greatest philosopher of all. That is Paribhu Manishi. That is 8th or 9th? 8th. And then Swayambhu means he is self-sufficient in himself. And then the last quality is, he is actually the one who awards the desires for, even up to the jnani who wants to go to Brahma Jyoti, is also a beggar from the Lord for moksha. Correct, no? And Lord is the one who is the awarder of varieties of desirables for different living entities. So how many qualities? 10 qualities are very vividly explained here. And this, please read the translation.
Such a person must...
These 10 qualities, a Uttam Adhikari is able to clearly see in the Lord. Therefore, he becomes attached to Lord. Correct, no? If you understand these 10 qualities well, we will have no attraction to the glittering illusion of this world. One will simply run after the Lord. Yeah.
Such a person must factually know the greatest of all, the personality of Godhead, who is unembodied, omniscient, beyond reproach, without veins, pure and uncontaminated, the self-sufficient philosopher who has been fulfilling everyone's desire since time immemorial. Here is a description of the transcendental and eternal form of the absolute personality of Godhead. The Supreme Lord is not formless. He has his own transcendental form, which is not at all similar to the forms of the mundane world. The forms of the living entities in this world are embodied in material nature, and they work like any material machine. The anatomy of a material body must have a mechanical construction with veins and so forth. But the transcendental body of the Supreme Lord has nothing like veins. It is clearly stated here that he is unembodied, which means that there is no difference between his body and his soul. Nor is he forced to accept a body according to the laws of nature as we are. In materially conditioned life, the soul is different from the gross embodiment and subtle mind. For the Supreme Lord, however, there is never any such difference between him and his body and mind. He is the complete whole, and his mind, body, and he himself are all one and the same.
Okay. So in the first para, some of the situations of the conditioned soul are explained here. In the first paragraph. For example, we all are embodied dehi. Like, you know, what is it? Dehi no asmin yatha dehe. So dehinaha is in the deha. We are trapped in the body. So the body is the vehicle and the soul is like the driver of the vehicle. We are trapped in this bodily vehicle. The example is given of a parrot kept in a cage or something like that. Correct, no? That's our situation here. And that's not the case with the Lord. It's the first thing Prabhupada says. He is not in a bodily machine like. And our bodily machine requires many functions like the bones. There are 7 things, you know, beginning with rasa, rakta, majja, medha, asti, shukra. Correct, no? There are 7 dhatus, which actually form the body as we eat the food. And then the veins are formed and muscles are there and bones are there. There are different parts of the body. There is a brain, there is a heart, and there is a kidney. So all these are actually functioning by the arrangement of the Lord. It's like a complex machine. So can anybody say why this complex machine is awarded to us? Why is this machine awarded? Why can't the soul be liberated and free? Why is this machine given? Yantra Rudhani Mayaya. This body made up of Maya, Maya's energy. Maya Shakti. Why is it given? Oh, this is awarded for fulfilling our independent desires. We want to enjoy independently. Now, for that it is given. Like we tell the example, no? Father tells the son, come with me in the Innova car. We are going to Bombay. But son says, why should you drive the car? I will drive the car. Huh? He If he is very adamant, father thinks my small kid is, he can't, his leg cannot even reach the brake or the clutches when he sits in the driver's seat. And what he wants to do? So what does he want to do? He wants to imitate his. Can the boy imitate? Small kid. But he wants to imitate. His father says, okay, beta, sit on my lap and you can drive. That also he doesn't agree. You know, why should I sit on your lap? So you will drive and I'll be doing natak. You know, I'll be just keeping the hand in my steering and then you will drive the car. I don't want all this drama. The boy says, you get out of the driver's seat and you sit behind. Mother, father, everybody behind and I will drive. It's adamant. So can the father allow him? Three things a father can do. One thing is leave him at home, lock him up and go with wife to Bombay and then come back in the evening. Is it all right for parents to do that? Can they lock up a child in a home? It's not proper. Or give him a tight slap and put him behind with the wife and then drive the car and take him to Bombay. Is it all right? And the third thing he can do is hand over the car to the boy, you know, a car, and put his wife also behind. He says, I'll, and father should stand outside so that there won't be any accident for him. And tell the boy, now you drive the car now. And the car, naturally the car will go and hit a tree or something. That'll be a terrible accident. And the boy gets all the, you know, the terrible things break in his body. And you know, nobody can say whether he will live or die. The hospital. Is it all right? So, if you have to avoid all the three, there is only one fourth possibility. Can you think of what? Give him a pedaling car, toy car. And that toy car is this machine which we all have now. Krishna has given us what? A toy car. He has given. So, the boy thinks, oh, I was asking my father's car. Now, he has given my own car. My own car is aham car. I am this car. He identifies with his own body, with his own car. So father says, Beta, you come in the sidewalk and I'll go in the main road. Like imagine if he has to go from Kunjibari temple, at the most the father can go up to the GPO, you know, post office. By the time the son comes there, what do you think will happen to him? He will get exhausted. Pedaling. After that, he'll be very exhausted. And he will tell the father, Papa, and Papa will ask him, what do you want? Enough of this pedaling car, keep it in the top. He'll put it in the top and then he will sit with father and then go to Bombay. Now he will be sitting in the front with the father and then looking at the scenery in Lonavala and talking to father nicely. The relationship is not spoiled. It's a sweet relation with the father. Father didn't slap him. Father didn't leave him behind. Father didn't allow his, big damage to happen to him. So now father is driving. So in this way, Krishna is the driver of the whole material and spiritual creation. He's a central figurehead. We should not imitate him, but we try to imitate him. So, in order to imitate him, he has given us this bodily car. Like for example, you know, Krishna has a wife, he has Rukmini, he has Satyabhama. Jiva says, hey, you have a wife, I will also have my wife. Okay, have your wife and see how life is. Then you have to face challenge. Then you have to give up your false ego. In a home, actually husband and wife and children have to live unitedly, lifelong. It's a big success. Because they all have to become tolerant and humble. What brahmacharis learn Trinadapi Shunichana by being in ashram, they have to learn by being in the family life. And those fellows who are very arrogant and who cannot be humble and tolerant, what they do? Divorce. Yeah. A woman also divorces a man. Man divorces a woman. I don't have to listen to you. I don't know. And they lead a very dry life. Yeah. Separated, divorcee. Or sometimes they marry second time, third time, fourth time. One cinema actress married 27 times. After that, four times she married the same fellow and left also. So you can see how horrible this world is. Actually, we divorced Krishna and came here. And here also we are divorcing other living entities also. We have a problem with everybody. So, therefore, he has given us this yantra rudani maya. This machine is given for us to imagine that everybody thinks I am the center of this world. Everyone should look at me. I am beautiful. I am rich. I am great. Whole world should revolve around me. So that I-centered consciousness. For that this body is given. Metal machine. But Krishna doesn't need a metal machine. He is always in his self same form. What is that? Sambhavami Atmamayaya. And the transcendental body of Supreme Lord is nothing like veins. Our body has veins. His body has no veins. Is there a blood flowing in Krishna's body inside? You know, are there bones inside? Whole body is completely spiritual substance. Like you take this sugar powder and you make a doll out of it. Anywhere you pinch, put in the mouth, it'll be sweet, isn't it? So in that way, Krishna's every part of his body is sweet. Like we say, adaram maduram, vadanam maduram. Maduradipater, akilam maduram. His glance is beautiful, his walk is beautiful, his smile is beautiful, his heart is beautiful, his personality is beautiful. There is nothing in him which is not beautiful. And those who want to see his non-beautiful face, they have to go and see Kaladopa, his Virat Rupa. If they want to see, and Arjuna never wanted to see that. He was submissive servant of Krishna. So, in this way, he is unembodied. And there is no difference between his body and soul, Prabhupada explains. And the next para?
In the Brahma Samhita 5.1, there is a similar description of the Supreme Lord. He is described there as Satchidananda Vigraha, which means that he is the eternal form fully representing transcendental existence, knowledge and bliss. As such, he does not require a separate body or mind, as we do in material existence. The Vedic literature clearly states that the Lord's transcendental body is completely different from ours. Thus, he is sometimes described as formless. This means that he has no form like ours and that he is devoid of a form which we can conceive of. In the Brahma Samhita 5.32, it is further stated that with each and every part of his body, he can do the work of the other senses. This means that the Lord can walk with his hands, accept things with his legs, see with his hands and feet, eat with his eyes, etc. In the Shruti Mantras, it is also said that although the Lord has no hands and legs like ours, he has a different type of hands and legs by which he can accept all that we offer him and run faster than anyone. These points are confirmed in this 8th mantra through the use of the words like Shukram, omnipotent.
Yeah. So, these things I explained to you in Shveta Kshetra Upanishad in the previous classes about how, you remember that? Pashyati Achakshuhu. What is the first? Apanipadu Javano Grihita. Pashyati Achakshuhu. Like that, it says that. Now, Lord doesn't, even without hands, the Lord can accept all the offerings, like Jagannath, I was telling you. And then his eyes are not seen by us. Where is God's eye watching? But his eyes are watching us. At every point, every atom he is watching like that. So, therefore, you will find Gajendra Moksha prayers. Gajendra says one beautiful verse. Na vidyate yascha cha janma karma va. ननाम रूपे गुणदोष एववा तथापि लोकाप्यय संभवायय स्वमायया तान्यनुकालं मृच्छति तस्मै नमः परेशाय ब्रह्मणे अनंत शक्तये अरूपायो रूपाय नमः आश्चर्यकर्मिणे. इज सेलिंग सी न विद्यते यस्य च जन्म कर्मवा. यू नो देयर ही हैज नो Janma and he has no karma. Who? Supreme Lord Krishna. He has no janma and no karma, he says. And na nama, he has no name also. Na nama rupe, he has no rupa also. But then he says, guna dosha evava, means what? Which means, he doesn't have a name or a form or birth or activities which is spoiled by the three gunas. That is the meaning. Guna dosha is not there. Do you agree that in our, these four things, guna dosha comes? Like a child is born ugly sometimes, isn't it? All child is born with a disfigured body, correct, no? Hands broken, legs broken, or blind, or whatever. No? So, in this way, some dosha comes into the janma. And in karma also, there are many karmas we do, which is vikarma, correct, no? It's a sinful activity, guna dosha, it comes in the due to rajaguna and tamaguna, especially sattvaguna, sattvarajastamas. Because of guna dosha, we behave improperly. And our name, nama and rupa also, a form already I told you. Our name also. Can we confidently say that our name suits our personality? Many times it's different. Lakshmipati is a name of a beggar. He is begging. He doesn't have a single penny, but his name is Lakshmipati. There are many people having names like that. Prabhupada gives the example of Padmalochan. Somebody is called Padmaraja and is a blind man. So our name doesn't fit our this thing, our personality. Not only that, in this world, very beautiful looking people, but they have no character. There are people. And there are people who are not so beautiful looking, but they have, they are gunavan or gunavati. You will see that. Like you ask any man who wants to marry, his parents are showing him 4 or 5 photos of girls. Generally, which girl he will choose? One who is looking beautiful and fair color, correct? No? But can you confidently say that beautiful girl is the one with best qualities? But he doesn't see the qualities. That is his foolishness, correct? No? So, ideally, if he's an intelligent boy, what he should ask? Will she be a chaste woman? Or she is good looking, she will run with the other playboys. Isn't it? You have to ask, no. And similarly, is she a Gunavati? Is she Charitra, Charitravan? Is she having Charitra? Will she be Gunavati? Will she have good qualities? So, people with good qualities are not necessarily beautiful always. People with good qualities are not necessarily beautiful in that way. Similarly, you find in this world, you find rich people are not always happy. And poor people are not always suffering in this world. You can see there are even beggars who are very smiling, very happily. And there are millionaires who are committing suicide in this world. That means, in this world, you find the guna dosh spoils all the living entities' lives, material lives, you can see. But the Lord is not like that. Actually, the 6 opulences are full in the Lord. And he manifests them so fully. He is also beautiful. He is also wealthy. He is also the most famous. He is also most strongest, most knowledgeable in every respect. That's what he says. Na vidyate yasya janma karma va na nama rupe guna dosha yeva va. And then he says, tatapi loka pyaya sambhavayaya swamayaya tanyanukala mrichyati swamaya. He comes in this world with his own internal potency. How he comes is explained here, next verse. Tasmai nama pareshaya. Para ishaya means he is the master of all the demigods. He is a transcendental Lord. I bow down to him, that transcendental Lord, he says. Nama tasmai nama pareshaya. Brahmane ananta shaktaye. One who has unlimited shaktis. Arupaya means what? He has no form. Uru rupaya means what? Many forms. See the contradiction. First he says arupaya, now he says uru rupaya. That means, arupaya means, hey, he doesn't have a form like you and me. But he has uru rupaya. He has many, many transcendental forms. Nirguna, when it says, hey, he is not caught by the 3 gunas like you and me. Sattvaguna, rajoguna, tamaguna. And then he is saying, ananta guna. Antam gunanam, agunasya jagmur. Yogeshwaraya, Bhavapadma Mukhya. Bhagavatam says, no? What is that word? Mahattamaikanta parayana, see what is the first line? Tanno bhavan bhai. No, that is second verse, or first verse. Mahattamaikanta parayana, nantam gunanam, agunasya jagmur, yogeshwara ye bhavapadma mukhya. He says, na antam gunanam. Oh, he has unlimited qualities, don't ask me. His ocean of qualities, unlimited qualities. And then he says, nantam gunanam, agunasya. What is the meaning? Is it not looking like contradiction? When Shastra says, Aguna says, has no quality, that means what no quality? There is no 3 modes. That guna, 3 gunas are not there. But na antam gunana, his qualities are unlimited. That quality is? Spiritual qualities, yeah. Like we say, he's a Bhakta Vatsala Govinda, he's Anahata Rakshaka, Apadbandhava, he's Mardava, Arjava, Saushilya, Karunya, all these qualities. Ocean of qualities. So whenever Shastra say that Anantashesh could not find an end to glorifying the Lord, what is he glorifying? Spiritual quality. And whenever Shastra say Nirguna means, what is the guna that is not in him? Therefore he says, Arupayoru Rupaya. He doesn't have a form like you and me, but he has unlimited forms. Like that he says, Nama Ashcharya Karmine. Therefore his activities are Ashcharya Karmane. Really? Earlier he said, na karma. There is no karma there, he says. But here is an ashcharya karma, he says. Therefore, his karma is not like, that is the point. So, therefore, in order to understand this, we have to study the Shastra and see, is there anybody in this world, any of you can come forward and extend your leg from the earth to the sky, like whatever Vamana Deva did? Think about it. Therefore, ashcharya karmane, or adbhuta karmane, correct, no? Is there anybody in this world who can kill all the series of demons who came to Vrindavan without any weapon? You know, he's catching somebody's neck and killing. He's putting his hand into Keshi's mouth and finishing him. He's entering Tagasura's mouth and killing him. And he's tearing the beaks and killing some creature. Just, you know, with his two lips, he's killing a big demoness. So therefore, he's Ashcharya Karmane. His activities are marvelous and wondrous. The living entities will be stunned forever if they hear those pastimes. So in this way, he's saying that it's not that he doesn't do activity. He's not like a stone. He does activity, but his activity and your activity, my activity are different. Like Lord Rama is looking at the ocean and boiling the whole ocean. We can't imitate those activities. He's lifting a Govardhan hill. He's swallowing the forest fire. Now we were going in the train. The early morning, one fellow was lying in the berth. The semi-closed eyes, he said, "Hey, chai leke aa? Chai." No, he called, then chai wala came. And chai wala took the chai and he was collecting money from another person. You know, vasool he was doing. And he was also giving the cup to that person. And that person was having semi-closed eyes. He was like little tired also. So he just took like this and started putting the cup in the mouth. It was like smoky hot, you know. So, like that, it jumped off his hands and the whole thing toppled down. It fell. And we all moved to the side. And it fell. So then he was shouting at that fellow. He said, "Hey, you are giving so hot. I will not pay you a single penny for this," he said. Because all the chai has gone down. So, and on that day only I was reading this Davanan Leela. I was laughing when I saw that. This fellow is not able to tolerate even one cup of hot tea, and Krishna swallowed Boris fire. Is it not true? So therefore his activities are not ordinary. Ashcharya Karmani, he says. Just see, we are not even able to take a little hot water, we are unable to take it. But Krishna is swallowing the forest fire, you can see that. Therefore, don't try to imitate him, you will die. It is said if you try to imitate him. So Lord, if somebody says, "Hey, Krishna is roaming in this world like you and me," I think his activities are like ours. "Hey, his activities are not like yours," Shastras immediately say. That means he has no activity. No, he has activity, but his activities are extraordinary. They are not ordinary. Next para.
The Lord's worshipable form, Archa Vigraha, which is installed in temples by authorized acharyas who have realized the Lord in terms of Mantra 7, is non-different from the original form of the Lord. The Lord's original form is that of Shri Krishna, and Shri Krishna expands himself into an unlimited number of forms such as Baladeva, Rama, Nrisimha and Varaha. All of these forms are one and the same personality of Godhead. Similarly, the Archa
Vigraha. What is that verse? Advaitam Achyutam Anadi Mananta Rupam Adyam Purana Purusham Navajauvanam Cha Vedesho Durlabham Adurlabham Atma Bhaktau Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. What is the meaning of good Advaitam here? If you tell something in the ears of Rama, Krishna will also know it. Vishnu will also know it. Because the person is a person. He only expands. When Advaita Acharya, you know, in order to declare himself a servant of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he went to that one place where he preached Yoga Vashishta. Mayavada he was preaching. So Nimaya Pandit went there. He heard the news. So he went and asked Advaita Acharya Prabhu, "Hey Advaita, please tell me, is the Supreme Truth personal or impersonal?" Then Advaita laughed and said, "Definitely the ultimate truth is impersonal, which is perceived by the speculative philosophers, and there is no higher truth than that," like that he was speaking. And Nimaya Pandit became so angry, he caught hold of him and pushed him to ground and sat on his body and said, "Hey Advaita, is this the reason for which you called me to come and hear this nonsense philosophy? You know, I was peacefully lying in the ocean of milk, and you woke me up from there and brought me here. And now you are speaking all this and I have to hear." And he bet him, and his wife came running, Sita Takarani, "Please don't beat the old man, he will die." And Advaita Acharya was laughing and laughing. He said, "My dear Lord, when Bhrigu came and kicked in your chest, at that time he exhibited great humility. Where is that humility gone now? Now we are beating me now. So in this way, Advaita defeated the Lord by establishing his position as a servant of the Lord. And then Vrindavan Thakur says, these pastimes will be written, added to the Vedas and Puranas in future Kalpas. He says, because this exceeds even the pastime of Bhrigumuni also. Well, Bhrigumuni's pastime, Lord could defeat the devotee by proving his humility. Whereas in this pastime, the Lord agreed to be defeated by his devotee, by the devotee's intelligence, to prove himself as a servant of the Lord. So, but why did he tell this pastime now? Because you will find, he said, I was lying in the milk ocean. Somebody heard it and said, oh, that means Chaitanya Mahaprabhu comes from Dugdhasagar, Kshirodaksha Vishnu only. Like this, some people will ask, which is not true. Actually, here is the principle of Advaita. Advaita means, Lord Chaitanya, Lord Kshirodaksha Vishnu, or Krishna, or Mahavishnu, they are all same, non-different. That's the meaning of Advaita. Yeah. So, that means, all the expansions of the Lord Swamshas, they will know. If you tell one of them, all of them will know it. Because the person is same, he's doing multiple acting. Like double acting, triple acting, like that, yeah. Like for example, your father, when he's at home, he may wear a lungi and a banyan or something. When he goes to, company, he may wear, formals. Correct, no? When he's going for a conference, he may go with blazers, tie, shoe and all those things. So his person is same, but he dresses differently according to the occasion. Now he's going for some marriage party, he will dress differently. Correct, no? So you will find that people look different in their attire and all according to the need of the situation. But the person is same. So Lord also expands himself like that. That's the point. Go ahead.
All of these forms are one and the same personality of Godhead. Similarly, the Archa Vigraha worshipped in the temple is also an expanded form of the Lord. By worshipping the Archa Vigraha, one can at once approach the Lord who accepts the service of a devotee by his omnipotent energy. The Archa Vigraha of the Lord descends at the request of the Acharyas, the holy teachers, and works exactly in the original way of the Lord by virtue of the Lord's omnipotence. Foolish people who have no knowledge of Sri Ishopanishad or any of the other Shruti mantras consider the Archa Vigraha, which is worshipped by pure devotees, to be made of material elements. This form may be seen as material by the imperfect eyes of foolish people or Kanishthadikaris, but such people do not know that the Lord, being omnipotent and omniscient, can transform matter into spirit and spirit into matter as he desires.
Yeah, correct. So when the Lord is seen by a materialist, the Lord turns spirit into matter. When the Lord is seen by a devotee with a spiritual vision, Lord turns matter into spirit. Because if you see, the deity is made up of 8 material elements given in the Shastra. So it's agreeable that the deity is made up of material elements only, when the deity is originally made and brought. But then when the Lord sees that the pure devotee is desire to lovingly serve him, he turns matter into spirit. And when the Lord is seeing that somebody is looking at him faithlessly and doesn't believe him, then the Lord turns spirit into matter. For he may give the material vision. Lord can do that. Like the currency note for a child is no better than any other paper. He sees the paper and the currency note are similar. So sometimes children, they take a 1,000 rupee note and crush it and put it in the mouth or tear it and throw it in dustbin because they don't know the value. But when you see it, you will see newspaper and currency note. In the newspaper, you throw it in Raddi. Currency note, you keep it in the pocket because you know its value. Correct, no? So those who have the spiritual vision can see the value of the deity, like the Prabhupada is saying. So there are impersonalists who became impersonalists because one of the reasons they became impersonalists was, like there is one famous impersonalist. So he said that he saw in the deity room the rats were running. And the rats were running and they were putting their mouth in the boga or something like that. So he got a doubt that this deity is not able to stop the rat from coming. So how is he God? Actually, for that matter, somebody may even ask, when Mughals came to India, they broke some of the temples, they broke the hands or legs of some deities also. Why the deities didn't defend themselves? Actually, there are many pastimes you will hear. If somebody misbehaved with the deity, they eventually faced a terrible situation over a period of time. Like you will hear in the Rajapur Jagannath temple, And one of the ladies, Muslim lady, she came to the temple. Just like this, she came. She didn't know there is a temple. And then she saw the temple and everything. She came with her other friends. So she sat in the temple, exactly showing her, you know, feet like this to the deities, like this. And then the pujari said, Mataji, you should not show like this. Feet is not proper. It's an offense to the Lord. If your legs are paining, you can turn it towards the garden side. Like the lady said. And she was not doing it innocently or unknowingly. She was doing it on purpose, deliberately. She was showing like this. And she was laughing and said, Kya farak padta hai? What difference it makes, you know. And this is the way I want to sit, she was telling. And Pujari was feeling very disturbed. Then he went and told some elder person. Another person came and told. She didn't listen to anybody, two, three people. Then the Pujari was closing the temple. And he was distributing prasad to different people. This lady also went in the line. She took the prasad and threw it in the garden. In the trees. You know. And I won't eat this. Like that. And Pujari was very upset. He said, see, if you don't want to eat, then why should you take and throw? You don't take it only, no? So he immediately went outside and he picked up the prasad. Because prasad should not be thrown like that. It's offensive. But as soon as this lady went home, she got a high fever. It went to 102, 103, 104, 105. And the doctor said, if it increases 2 more degrees, she will die. Then she told the husband, I think I did some offense in the temple. You run to the temple immediately. You meet the pujari and tell sorry to the Lord and get me some prasad from there. So then the husband went there and offered obeisances to the Lord on behalf of wife and circumambulated, took some prasad from the temple. Because after she got the fever, 3-4 days fever was not reducing even 1 degree also. Doctors raised their hands. They said, sorry, we don't think she is going to get cured. But when she ate the prasad, she immediately got cured. After that, she came to temple. In this way, you will find somebody offending the deity has faced a terrible situation. Actually, there are many real life stories that happened in British times also. British times, the British people, some of them offended some of the lords by speaking ill of them in their front, and they got terrible things. There are many, many stories you will hear that. In the same manner, you will find that even there was one demigod Devi in the north. You know, they removed her from the temple and took her to another place, and there were heavy floods, you know that? I think 2 years ago. Heavy, big, terrible floods in that locality and killing a lot of people. It came in the paper. So, actually they understood. Actually, even when they removed Devi, Devi got angry. Hey, why are you guys moving me from this place to another without, you know, any reason? For some other ordinary reason they did that. So, sometimes the deity can become angry also and can severely punish people who are misbehaving, who are mistreating. Anandapadma also happened. No? What happened there? See the mic then?
I heard that some politician declared that whatever wealth has been recovered from the wallet will be taken by the government, and he died within next day or something.
Correct. That's true, yeah. That is also like that, yeah. Yes, that is true, yeah. I don't want to mention the name. There was one PM in those days who was not allowed into Jagannath Puri. One Prime Minister. And that she said, oh, really? I won't be allowed? Then I'll fly in a helicopter and watch from there. So, they flew in a helicopter over the Jagannath Puri tower. Next day, she was passed away. So there are many. If you see the connection, you can see that. If somebody does something in an offensive mood with the deities, they will get terrible problems. So, and also, but many times people don't know the connection. Why something is happening to somebody. For example, in the deity room, if some sinful activities happen between man and woman or something like that, if the Lord is displeased, terrible things will happen. There have been accidents. There have been actually natural calamities, accidents and terrible situations happen when Lord is displeased. Through these things, Lord is exhibiting His anger towards people who are not preserving the purity and standards of their this thing, yeah. And they get a little bit punishment. And actually, therefore, if you read the Alvar stories and all, you come to understand how when the Lord is displeased with the devotee, he will create a situation for the devotee in such a way that the devotee will get punishment in case the devotee misuses like that. Now, apart from this, we also should know that the deity is not coming to declare his supremacy or declare his prowess. Like when Krishna comes, there is not one single war in which he was defeated. You will see that. Because nobody can cut Krishna's body. Nobody can burn his body. Nobody can harm him. Nobody can favor him. That's what world saw it when he was here. He is indefeatable, unconquerable. Everybody saw that. But when he comes as a deity form, one should know that the deity form is not coming to declare his supremacy or prowess like the way he comes as an avatara. Correct, in this world. The deities are especially coming to receive the service of his devotees. Actually, the deity form is a small form. If you see the Utsava Murtis we handle, it is Lord agreeing to the pure devotee to become malleable in the heart of the disciples of the Guru. The disciples of the Guru are picking him, putting him in the yantra, offering him abhishek, feeding him madhupak, you know, and then dressing him, decorating him. He becomes helpless in the hands of the devotees. Correct, no? He's totally helpless. So why should he become helpless? On the request of a pure devotee. Therefore, he agrees for that position. Otherwise, he has no reason to do that. So, he comes in a mood of receiving service. But if somebody, like for example, I have a clock. And I break the sticks of the clock and say, now the time cannot move, somebody says. Is he not a fool? Okay. You may break one or six of the clock. That doesn't mean time is going to stop. The clock is only an indicator of the time. But the time is anyway flowing. Similarly, the deity form of the Lord is present in this world as an indicator of Krishna in the spiritual world. At the same time, Krishna in the spiritual world can accept all your services through the medium of the deity. And he says in Tashtadhatu, you make my form like this and you utilize this form. And then you can derive full benefit. Just like, for example, there may be electronic circuit. You have electronic circuit. You can do two things with the circuit. One is, if you connect it to the right wires and to the right device, you can watch a TV with that. Or you can run a clock, isn't it? You can run a tape recorder or something with the circuit. And if a child is getting this PCB, can you do anything with that? What will he do? You know, even small children sometimes have a circuit in their hand, correct? Printed circuit, but they can't. Deity is also like that. If you have a deity and if you are getting guidance of a pure devotee, then you can benefit from the deity. In many homes, you will see they have the deity of the grandfather, grandmother, and the cobwebs in their puja room. Because they don't know what to do with it. And you go to the hall, everybody is sitting in the hall with a big TV on, watching, and the deities are unattended. So the deity is sometimes maybe. When the deity sees that I am not taken care well, then he will go underground. Like you find in the Madhavendrapuri's pastime, we hear about how Lord had gone underground and then he told Madhavendrapuri to bring him out. Why? When nobody is there to serve him, the Lord will find out a way to become unmanifest. And then whenever the Lord feels some pure devotee who is great with great love, he is chanting my name. He will come in the dream of the pure devotee and say, hey, my pure devotee. You have so much love in your heart, you get me out. Now I want to receive worship from you. So then the Lord put him at the top of Govardhan Hill. Our Madhavendrapuri. Then he worshipped Gopal. Then he went to Neelachal to bring Chandan for him and all that. And then I celebrated Annakut for 2 years. Correct, no? So in this way, the deities are here to receive service from the pure devotees. And along with pure devotees, we can also join hands with them, although we are not pure devotees. If you just go with them, you also get opportunity to access him. Just like, one time my spiritual master was going to some temple in South India. You know, Radhakund Prabhu called me, hey, Prabhu, you also come. I said, see Prabhuji, this is only for Maharaj, they are giving permission. You know, there are 1,000 people waiting outside, nobody is allowed inside. I am not comfortable to come. He said, no, you come. They will allow us also, you know. I know, so he pulled me, so he took me. So he said, but you keep on walking with Maharaj, you know, because Maharaj will walk and behind, then we can say as one team like that. So you are going, Maharaj walk, every gate they will allow Maharaj and look at us, who are you, you know? And then Radhakund Prabhu will say that, hum bhi Swamiji ke saath hain. साथ में स्वामी जी को लेके जाने के लिए हम लोग आए हैं, वी आर लाइक बॉडी गार्ड बोथ साइड्स, सो वी आर गोइंग, बट वन वॉचमैन वॉज वेरी स्ट्रिक्ट, ही अलाउड महाराज टू गो एंड ही वॉज नॉट अलाउइंग लास्ट वन, यू नो. देन राधाकुंड प्रभु लुक्ड एट हिम एंड सेड, हम भी महाराज के साथ आए, सो नो नो नो, आप लोग बाहर रहने का, यू गो आउटसाइड, महाराज विल टेक दर्शन एंड कम, ही सेड. देन राधाकुंड प्रभु टोल्ड हिम, ये छोटा महाराज है, ही सेड, ही इज लुकिंग, यू नो, ये भी महाराज है, ठीक है आप जाइए. Then he didn't allow Radhakant Prabhu. Then he asked him, what about you? Hampi chote maharaj, okay, tum beja. Then, yeah. So, in this way, sometimes what happens, when you go with a big person, you also get chance along with him. That's what, similarly, Madhavendra Puri is the lover of Gopal. But in his name of he worshipping, everybody got opportunity to see Gopal, serve Gopal, worship him, do Abhishek for him. Celebrate festivals for him, correct, no? So this is a beauty. So similarly, you see Sakshi Gopal also. Because that Brahmana called him with love. And Lord asked him, hey, Brahmana, you have so much faith in me that, you know, you are calling me to your place to give Sakshi. Have you ever seen deities walking? He said. What did he say? My dear Lord, if deity can speak, deity can also walk. Lord got defeated. Oh, you are very greatly logical. I can't escape your logic. Okay, I will come behind you, but you should not look back. Huh? And whenever, if you look back, I will stop in that place, he said. So, Lord's Nupur sound was, chh, chh, chh. He could hear that. So, in this way, Lord walked behind him, although he was a deity in a temple, which means you can see faith can move mountains, we say. In the same manner, faith can move the deities also, if one has a very firm faith. So, in this way, there are pastimes which show immense faith of the pure devotee in the Lord. So Lord has reciprocated with Madhavendra Puri or that Sakshi Gopal Brahmana or Raghunandan Thakur or Jagannath reciprocating with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's dancing and all that. And Prabhupada speaking to Radha Ras Bihari, he told Radha Ras Bihari, don't worry, very soon I'll make a beautiful temple for you. Right now you're staying in a thatched hut kind of thing. And Prabhupada made a big temple eventually. So in this way, our Sanatana Goswami speaking to Madan Mohan, offering him bati without salt, isn't it? So, in this way, through these pastimes, you understand that, see, he only had a Shaligram Shila, Gopalabhatta Goswami. And Narasimha Chaturdashi day night, he saw all the Goswamis are dressing their deity and I can't dress because I only have a Shaligram Shila. So, he had tears in his eyes. This rich man is giving nice dresses and ornaments, but I can't put it for the Lord. Thinking like that, he slept. Next day morning, what happened? From that, Shaligram Shila came out, Radha Raman. And he was amazed because below Radha Raman's feet, there is still that Shaligram Shila. And above that, in fact, scientists had a little doubt. They thought they must attach something. They conducted a test also to check whether this stone and that stone are same. It was proven. Radha Raman has come from the Shaligram Shila only. Small, beautiful deity. And then Gopalabhatta Goswami also could decorate, and one of the most beautiful deities. And he had the beauty combined of all the three, Madan Mohan, Govinda and Gopinath, all of them like that. So, in this way you will see, with those who are faithful, the Lord reciprocates. With those who are faithless, he appears like ordinary stone or wood for them. And those who are atheistic and harmful, they can't harm the Lord. Lord actually inspires the devotees to take him to, because devotees also get a chance to intensify their love for the Lord whenever danger comes. Correct, no? For example, once Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wanted to take darshan of Gopal, but Gopal was above in the hilltop and he wouldn't climb up because he had the sentiment that Govardhan is also Krishna and you can't climb on Krishna's body. So as he was desiring to see Gopal, what happened? Some news reached the pujaris that some dangerous enemies are coming and we have to save the Lord. So what they did? They brought the Lord in a palanquin down. Correct, no? All people fell on the ground and offered obeisances. Mahaprabhu could get darshan. Isn't it? For 3-4 days it was like that. And afterwards, then they came to know, no more enemies came. There's no danger now. Again, the Lord went back. So how the Lord reciprocates with the love of his devotees? We can see that. He inspires the devotees to do things, as he did with Madhavendra Puri also. So in this way, with faithful, he will reciprocate. You know, with faithless, he will appear like a material thing. And with those who are harming the Lord, Thanaham Dushatakuran, Samsareshu, Naradhaman, Chipami, Ajasram, Mashubhan, Asurishu Yeva Yonishu, Asurim Yonimapanna, Mudha, Janmani Janmani, Mam Aprapyaiva Kaunteya, Tato Yanti Adamam Gatim. He's saying, he says that these people who are fools and rascals and rogues, who are not only religious, who are not only atheistic, but who try to destroy the religious principles, I cast them into bodies of dogs and cats and rats and cockroaches and amoebas. In this way, lower and lower and lower bodies they get. Ultimately, they go to such a low-class form. They will be worm in the stool for millions of years. Because such living entities are extremely antagonistic and asuric in nature. And they will suffer and they will eventually come. That will take long, long time. They have to suffer for that. Now, therefore, as preachers, if we find somebody is very antagonistic, we should not preach. We should actually pat them on the back and say, continue to be a demon. Do whatever you want. As Prabhupada said, one boy said, Swamiji, anyway, if I become a dog in the next life, I will not even remember this life, isn't it? He said, Prabhupada said, okay, I bless you to be a dog. Go and be a dog if you want. Because if a Madhyamadhikari preacher preaches to such faithless people, a Madhyamadhikari will become angry. When you become very angry, your heart becomes disturbed, mind becomes polluted. Then for you to have softness of heart to worship Krishna, you will have difficulty with that. And also the faithless people blaspheme the Lord and the scriptures and the path of devotional service. By hearing those blasphemies, one's faith in the Lord will be damaged. So one should not therefore associate with choirs fools who are 10th class rascals and rogues. Those who thrive in nefarious activities. He says, Ashuchi Vratau, he says. He says, Pravrittim cha nivrittim cha janana vidurasura na shaucham na pichacharo na satyam teshu vidyate. Either he says, they do not know what is good behavior. They do not know what is right, what is wrong. They have no knowledge at all. So, one should never associate with such people. And we don't have time for such fellows. Even the hippie people, they were faithful. Although they had bad qualities, bad behavior and all that, they were faithful and they were very inquisitive also. You see the kind of questions they asked Prabhupada in the recordings, you find. Therefore, Prabhupada preached. Otherwise, atheists and faithless people, it's useless to waste time with them. Even if somebody is suffering from faithlessness due to modern day education, then we may explain the right thing. But even after hearing the right thing, one continues to doubt. One has no faith and one is blasphemous, then he is not a fit candidate for preaching. If you continue to preach to him, you are doing 9th offense. Go ahead.
In the Bhagavad Gita 9.11-12, the Lord regrets the fallen condition of men with little knowledge who deride him because he descends like a man into this world. Such poorly informed persons do not know the omnipotence of the Lord. Thus the Lord does not manifest himself in full to the mental speculators. He can be appreciated only in proportion to one's surrender to him. The fallen condition of the living entities is due entirely to forgetfulness of their relationship with God.
Yeah, so the speculators, the jnanis, think that they can figure out God themselves by study of scriptures, by analysis, by evaluation, by stretching their mind and intelligence. So they have more faith in what? Their own capabilities. Therefore, the Lord does not reveal himself to them. That verse says, Shreya Shritim Bhakti Mudasyate Vibho Klishyanti Eke Valabodhalabdhaye Teshamasau Kleshalaye Vashishyate Nanyat Yatastu Latusha Vagatina. In this verse, Brahmaji says that. He says, my dear Lord, Shreya Shritim Bhaktim Udasyate Vibho. These people who give up the path of bhakti and by their own speculation they try to figure out the understanding of is God personal or impersonal. Like they say, God can't be personal. They say, why? See, if he is personal, he will be localized in one place. How he can actually manage millions of universes? It's just not for that he has to be impersonal so he can spread everywhere. This is how they speculate. So foolishly. Actually, Krishna says, Goloka Nevasati. He not only expands himself through his energies, He also is present in every atom, in space between atoms. That's how he expands. But they don't even wait to hear this truth. Before that, only they speculate. Another example I'll tell you. One very famous Swami in India, he said, you know, if dogs were to make a god, they would make one big bulldog as a god. And if all the animals in the forest were to make a god, they would make one big animal to be, you know, god. In the same manner, when humans want to make a god, they make one famous human to be a god. It's all man-made. Sorry. God is not like you and not like me. God is impersonal, like that he speaks. So, now where did this fellow get this argument? It is from his own 200 gram of gray matter from the head. From there he got this. And nowhere the Shastras say that. The Shastras say that actually you are not making God, God made you. For example, if a child going to school is weeping and teacher is asking, why are you weeping? And child says, you know, I am remembering my parents at home, you know. So the child remembering parents is not imagination of the child. The parents are actually existing. And the child is remembering the parents fondly. So child is crying. And in the same manner, if a teacher says, why are you creating your parents, mother and father? Child is not creating parents. Parents created the child. Isn't it? Similarly, God has made man in his own image. God made man in his own image. So our forms are actually resembling Krishna's and Radharani's form in this world, man and woman. God has made. This is said in the 11th canto when Krishna created all the different species of life. He was not satisfied because all were ignorant species, foolish species. None of them could actually do self-realization and attain God. And at last Krishna created a human form which is resembling him. And a female form which is resembling Radharani's form. So it's mentioned in the 11th canto that Lord created like that. So in the, on the same Swamiji, the famous Swami I told you, he told another bluff. What is it? He said, if I were to water a plant, I would rather water an eggplant instead of watering a tulasi, he said. Because eggplant will give me some eggplant vegetable. It will come from the tulasi, doesn't give me any vegetable. What is the use, he said. Prabhupada says, even there are dogs which lift their leg and pass urine. You have seen that. Anything they smell and they pass urine, you have seen that. So, people who criticize tulasi are like that only. Like those dogs, because they don't know the value of tulasi. The value of tulasi, if you see, tulasi may not have a fruit. Tulasi may not have a flower. But tulasi is most dear to Vishnu. Tulasi, Krishna prayasi. So, our understanding and conviction comes from scripture. So, this Swami never studied scripture. He is a big talker. He may have a vak chaturyam. He may have the big mouth to speak and impress the people and get applause from the people. But he's a big bluffer. He doesn't study the Shastra. So, any of us speak, we should study Shastra and repeat. So, why do we bow down to Tulasi? Why do we circumambulate Tulasi? Because Acharyas have done it. Acharyas have taught it based on the scripture. So, therefore, here he is saying that the speculator will never come to the right understanding. And Lord will never reveal himself. Here it says, Atapite Dev. Now, I told you this verse. Yashatim bhakti mudasyate vivo klishyantiye ke valabodhalabdaye. And the example he gives. Nanyat yatastula tushavagatina. If you are taking an empty husk and you hit it and hit it and hit it. Generally, husk should be hit when the grains are there. Then when you hit, what comes out? Grains come. But if you hit a grainless husk, if somebody is hitting for a long time all day, will they get anything? Yes, they will get one very important thing. What is it? Labor, pain in the hands. That's the advantage you will get. That's why he's saying, Nanya Tatasula. He's saying, Shreya Shrutim Bhakti Mudasyate Vibho Klishyanti Eke Valabodhalabdeye. Klishyanti. They will get a very wonderful commodity. What is it? Klesh in the hand. That's all they will get. They won't get the grains. So the speculators, they take their mind and hit again and again. They try on their own to figure out that they will never figure out the truth. And then he says in the next verse, he says, Atapite deva padambujadvaya prasad lesha anugrihita evahi janati tatvam bhagavan mahimno nachanyame ko pichiram vichinvan. He's saying, oh my dear Lord, if somebody rejects your lotus feet, Atapite deva pada ambujadvaya prasada. They don't accept the little bit of prasad mercy from you also to understand you. Even if one receives a trace of your mercy, they can begin to understand you. But a person who rejects your lotus feet can never understand. That's the thing this para says. Go ahead, next one. In this mantra?
In this mantra as well as in many other Vedic mantras, it is clearly stated that the Lord has been supplying goods to the living entities.
From this onwards, up to the end, it's a very simple theme. That is, the Lord is the charitable giver, charity giver for all beggars, beginning from the karmis up to the jnanis. Karmis, jnanis, yogis, everybody extends their hand. Karmi comes and says, my Lord, give me dharam, janam, sundarim. Jnani comes here, give me moksha. Yogi comes, give me siddhis. He just gives everybody, chalo, take it and push off. Now this guy is interested in me. They are simply business fellows. Theek hai, leko, leke jao, nikal ja. Go and do your own thing. But bhaktas go to the Lord and say, my dear Lord, please give me service. Really, service of whom? Service to you. Now, what do you want for yourself? I don't want anything. You don't want to be Indra or a Brahma or moksha also. You would say, I don't want anything. I want to be with you. I want to serve you. I want to love you. That's all. Then therefore Lord is deeply touched by the devotees. Lord Vishnu says to Durvasa, two things in the devotee is deeply touched his heart, Lord Vishnu's heart. One is devotee is not wanting moksha also. Moksha wants also, devotees are given up. And another one, he says, the compassion in the heart of the devotee to deliver the other jivas. These two things attracted very much. Go ahead. Now we can continuously read the next full para.
Yeah. In this mantra, as well as in many other Vedic mantras, it is clearly stated that the Lord has been supplying goods to the living entities from time immemorial. A living being desires something.
What is
the
verse?
Lord,
Nityo Nityanam Chetanas Chetananam Yeko Bahunam Yo. Yes.
A living being desires something, and the Lord supplies the object of that desire in proportion to one's qualification. If a man wants to be a high court judge, he must acquire not only the necessary qualifications, but also the consent of the authority who can award the title of high court judge. The qualifications in themselves are insufficient for one to occupy the post. It must be awarded by some superior authority. Similarly, the Lord awards enjoyment to living entities in proportion to their qualifications, but good qualifications in themselves are not sufficient to enable one to receive awards. The mercy of the Lord is also required.
For example, he says, Prithu Maharaj says, Aham Dandadaro Raja Prajanam Niyojitaha, he says, I am actually holding the chastising rod as a scepter, we call it, scepter. I am holding it and I am ruling the kingdom. And who posted me here? Supreme Lord, he says. To rule over the praja, Lord has given me this post, he says. That means you may be qualified for the post, but it's not necessary that people have to choose you. Unless you have blessing from the Lord. Like that he says, you will find many, many people in this world, highly qualified people. You know, there are many unqualified people who are raised to the post also. The Prabhupada says everybody in this world gets ultimately only what Lord sanctions. Not even a blade of grass can move without his sanction. Yeah. Go ahead. Therefore, Pandavas were always aware of this. Although they were champions in the world in everything, they knew that without Krishna's mercy, you can't achieve anything. They had full conviction in that. Yeah.
Ordinarily, the living being does not know what to ask from the Lord, nor which post to seek. When the living being comes to know his constitutional position, however, he asks to be accepted into the transcendental association of the Lord in order to render transcendental loving services.
Yeah, one example I'll tell you. Say, for example, you have done some big service. Now you go to Guru and say, Guruji, see what service I have done. Shastra says, Yasya Prasada, better you be pleased with me. Huh? Because this is a service. See, I have the track record. If you go and tell Guru, will Guru be pleased? Huh? So can somebody force the Guru to be pleased just because you have done the work? So along with your good work, what will Guru expect? Right attitude. Correct, no? You don't even go and show off to Guru. And Guru comes to know from somebody else and he calls you, please come here. Hey, you have done so much service. Prabhu, what can I do? I have no ability. Whatever I do is all your mercy, he says. Then his mercy comes. Correct, no? Therefore, only by your qualification, you cannot say that, like you go to the door of Goloka and kick with the boots and tell them, hey, open the door. And Lord is saying, why should I open? Here is my certificate. I have done so many years of service. Can you say that? No, Lord's mercy is required. Yeah.
Unfortunately, living beings under the influence of material nature ask for many other things, and they are described in the Bhagavad Gita 2.41 as having divided or splayed intelligence.
Bahushakahi anantascha buddhayo avyavasayinam. Yeah.
Spiritual intelligence is one, but mundane intelligence is diverse.
Vyavasayatvika buddhir. Yes.
In Srimad Bhagavatam 7.5.30-31, it is stated that those who are captivated by the temporary beauties of the external energy forget the real aim of life, which is to go back to Godhead. Forgetting this, one tries to adjust things by various plans and programs, but this is like chewing what has already been chewed. Nonetheless, the Lord is so kind that He allows the forgetful living entity to continue in this way without interference. Thus, this mantra of Sri Ishopanishad uses the very appropriate word Yatha Tathyatah, indicating that the Lord rewards the living entities just in pursuance of their desires. If a living being wants to go to hell, the Lord allows him to do so without interference. And if he wants to go back home, back to Godhead, the Lord helps him. God is described here as Paribhu.
See, this is the verse 7.5.30. Matirna Krishne Paratasvatova Mito Vipadyeta Griha Vratana Adanta Govir Vishatam Tamishram Punah Punah Charvita Charvanana. A person cannot become attracted to Krishna by his own effort or by others' preaching or by joint conferences because he has uncontrolled senses and he is independent minded, so he enters the darkest of the hell and he keeps on repeating the same sinful activities over and over again. Yeah. So in this way, every living entity has his own desire. Huh? Karmi, Jnani, Yogi and everybody, they have their program with which they have come to this world. Prabhupada says they have their various plans and programs. Everybody has chewing the chewed, he says. Yeah. So, yata tatita means according to yetama, prapanyadi gives. Next para.
God is described here as paribhu, the greatest of all. No one is greater than or equal to him. Other living beings are described here as beggars who ask goods from the Lord. The Lord supplies the things the living entities desire. If the entities were equal to the Lord in potency, if they were omnipotent and omniscient, there would be no question of their begging from the Lord even for so-called liberation. Real liberation means going back to Godhead. Liberation as conceived of by an impersonalist is a myth, and begging for sense gratification has to continue eternally unless the beggar comes to his spiritual senses and realizes his constitutional position.
Yeah, we can stop with that. And the next para has two very important qualities, self-sufficient and shuddham apapavidham will take time. I'll extend it along with the ninth verse. Next verse, I will explain it along with that. Srila Prabhupada ki, or Bhakta Vrinda ki. You can remember that.